Thank you, Tom. What a wonderful song. Take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Luke, Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1, we're going to pick it up in verse 39 here in just a minute. This morning we're going to be looking at one of those passages of Scripture that's kind of overlooked when it comes to studying God's Word, especially around the Christmas season. We kind of ignore this piece. One of my favorite parts of Christmas has to be the music. I love Christmas songs, Christmas music, Christmas carols. I love what we did. If you missed the cantata last week because of the snow and the ice, you really missed a wonderful performance. I mean, it was just it brought glory and honor to the Lord Jesus Christ. It was really good. Appreciate Jim and the choir doing their thing. But you know, you just can't escape it. Everywhere you go, you turn the radio on and you hear Christmas songs. You go shopping and you hear Christmas music. And you know, the truth is, some of it still brings a tear to my eye. Mary, Did You Know? Oh my goodness, I hear that song, Mary, Did You Know? And it makes me want to cry. And then others, that doesn't bring a tear to my eye, it brings indigestion to my stomach, you know. Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer. Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer. I mean, that raises all kinds of questions for me. Like, who would write something like that? And the biggest question is, why would they write something like that? What do they have against Grandma that they would write something like that? I don't get it. It becomes that earworm, you know, that you just can't get out of your mind. You just keep singing it. All of you are going to leave this place. You're going to be going, Grandma Got Run Over. All day long you'll be doing that. Oh. But the truth is that Christmas has always been on display in music. Since the very beginning, since the very first Christmas. And I'm not talking about the angels as they sang. That was a Christmas song of sorts, as the angels appeared before the shepherds and began to sing. I'm talking about something that goes back even a little further. I'm talking about something that scholars have for centuries called the Magnificat. It's Mary's song. It's the song that she sings. It's a beautiful truth that reveals something to us. Because as followers of Christ, like Mary, you and I, we have something to sing about this Christmas. We have something to rejoice in. We have something to celebrate. We have a song that we need to sing. Let me set the stage for you. An angel of the Lord has appeared to Mary and told her that she is going to be pregnant, that she's going to bear a child, that she will have a son who will be the Son of God and the Savior of the world. She's only about 14 at this time, and she doesn't understand it all. She certainly can't wrap her mind around everything that's going on, but she knows that if it's true, there's going to be trouble. In fact, her fiancé, the man she was engaged to, Joseph, he's visited in a dream as well, and he discovers that she's expecting, because he's thinking, she's pregnant, it's not my child. I think I'm going to distance myself from the situation. I'm just going to put her away quietly. We're going to make sure nobody attaches me to this baby that's going to be born. So the circumstances aren't really great. And in the process, Mary decides to go and see someone else who's expecting. This time, it's one of her relatives named Elizabeth, an older woman who's expecting a child who will be John the Baptist. And the Bible tells us in the Gospel of Luke that when they meet and Mary greets Elizabeth, John the Baptist in Elizabeth's womb begins to celebrate. He begins to sing a song and to jump around and to dance a little bit because he leaps in his mother's womb. That's where we pick the story up. And Mary, in response to what Elizabeth tells her, she begins to sing the Magnificat. And in this song, we discover that no matter what's going on in our lives, we have something to sing about this Christmas. We have reason to celebrate this Christmas. Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 39. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Listen to what it says. Listen to what it says. Now Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste to a city of Judah. And she entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. And it happened, when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, that the babe leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then she spoke out with a loud voice and said, Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. But why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leapt in my womb for joy. Blessed is she who believes, for there will be a fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord. That's Elizabeth's confession. Now Mary breaks into song. And Mary said, my soul sings and magnifies and praises the Lord. My spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for he has regarded the lowly estate of his maidservant. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arms. He's scattered the proud in their imaginations of their heart. He's put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He's filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he sent away empty. He's helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. What a beautiful, I wish I could sing the song, but it would probably have been in Hebrew and you wouldn't have understood it anyway. But I'm going to teach you about the song that she sang, because I really believe that this Christmas season, there is reason because of the birth of Christ. There is reason because of the coming of Christ that you and I should have something to sing about. I have a lot to sing about. Turn to the person on your right, the person on your left, and tell them, I have a lot to sing about. Tell them right now. Now listen, I know some of you are sitting there and you're going, but I can't carry a tune in a bucket, I'm not singing anything. I'm here to tell you, by the time we're done with this morning, you're going to feel like you have a lot to sing about. It doesn't matter if you can't sing on cue or on key. That it's irrelevant. You still have a lot to sing about. Get your outlines out. Let's look at them together. We'll work on them together. I have a song to sing, number one, when I focus on God and not my situation. I have a song to sing when I focus on God and what He's doing and not my situation. Listen, I understand that this has been a really busy week for hospitals here around us. We're coming to the end of the year. Everybody's having their surgeries. And people that didn't even plan on doing it, so their deductible was met, they're having surgery. We just have lots of people that are experiencing all kinds of difficulty. But I'm here to tell you, you have a lot to sing about if you will not focus on your situation and instead focus on God. Notice what Mary does in this passage. I've given it to you here. I'm using the New Living Translation in your outlines. Oh, how my soul praises the Lord. 20 times in this passage, Mary will refer to God. 8 times she will specifically say, I'm praising God for what He has done for me. I praise God for what He has done for me. She realizes she's 14. Her situation is not good. She's 14 and expecting and unmarried. Her situation is not good. And the reality is, in that culture and in that society, she will be ostracized. You know what Joseph's family is saying about her. That little slut. I'm sorry. That little hussy. Who does she think she is? It would be very easy for Mary in that situation, in those circumstances, to get very depressed, to get very discouraged, to look at her situation in her life and to be overwhelmed by it. But she doesn't. She sings a different song. She's singing, do you see what I see? Because she's not focused on her circumstances, she's focused instead on God and His promise and His word and what He has said to her, that the child within her, that the baby she will deliver will be her deliverer. She begins to realize she has a song to sing. If she doesn't focus on her circumstance and on her situation, if she focuses on her God, she has a song to sing. Listen, I understand that we face, at this time of the year, relationship issues come up and financial issues come up and medical issues come up and our health may be going south and all kinds of things may be happening to us. But I'm here to tell you, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, don't focus on your circumstance. Instead, focus on your God. Amen. Focus on God. And you'll find you have a song to sing. We need to focus on who He is and what He has done. You may be sitting here and going, well, I do have a song to sing, preacher. It's Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen. Nobody knows my... You know what? I don't have to know what you're going through. And nobody else may be able to identify exactly with what you're going through. But I will tell you this. Our God is a great God. And there's a song to sing if we focus our lives on Him. Regardless of our circumstance. Second thing. Not only do I have a song to sing when I focus on God, not my situation. Number two, I have a song to sing when I know I have found my Savior. When I know that I found my Savior. Notice what Mary confesses in her song. How my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. Mary looks beyond her situation. She looks beyond everything that people are whispering about her and saying about her. And she looks instead to her God and she focuses on Him and what He has told her and what He has promised. And she understands that the baby within her will be her Savior. Now listen, she doesn't understand everything that's going to entail. She's not sure what all is going to go on in that. She doesn't know about the death, burial, and resurrection. She just knows that the promise of God was that child will save His people from their sins. Listen, she's singing a new song. See, for generations preceding that first Christmas, mankind since the beginning has been singing, I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. I mean, Bing Crosby. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. Adam and Eve from the garden were dreaming of a day that would come when the seed would come and would break the curse. Isaiah put it this way. He was dreaming of a white Christmas when he proclaimed, thus says the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Generations preceding Mary, generations preceding the birth of Christ, generations after generation, they were dreaming of a white Christmas. I have a song to sing. I'm not dreaming of a white Christmas. I'm living a white Christmas. I am forgiven and I am His. The song should change because of that baby that Mary carried. She focused her attention upon the Father. She focused her attention upon God. But the reality was she had found her Savior. Oh, how my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. This Christmas season, we have a song to sing. I'm living in a white Christmas. I am forgiven and I'm His. I mean, what more do we need? What more do we want? Here's what we have to understand. You know, the hardest people to buy for, this is what we say. What do you get for somebody that's got everything? What do you get for someone that's got everything? Let me tell you the truth. You can have everything and not have anything. You can have everything and be dreaming of a white Christmas and have absolutely nothing. Now, please understand, I'm not talking about snow here. I'm talking about the forgiveness of our sins. Because the Bible says that my life before the first Christmas, that the best it could be was filthy rags. But I'm singing a new song. I am forgiven and I am His. It's a white Christmas for me. We're not talking race here. We're talking sin here. I am forgiven, and I am His. Whew. I got a song to sing. How about you? Want to join in the song? Let's keep going. I have a song to sing when I focus on God, not my situation. I have a song to sing when I found my Savior. Number three, I have a song to sing when I realize that when I follow God, I am blessed. Mary realized it. Notice what he said. For he took notice of his lowly servant girl. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed. Mary confesses that she's nothing but a lowly servant girl. But God noticed her. God saw her. God knew what she was experiencing and what she was going through. And I will tell you, this Christmas season, you may feel like everybody is missing you. You may feel like there's no present under the tree, that nobody cares about where you are in life. Nobody picks up, nobody notices you. You're the person that always is in the back, that nobody ever, but I got to tell you something. God knows exactly what's going on in your life. He knows exactly where you are. He knows what's happening to you. He takes notice of you. He knows who you are and how you feel and what's going on. And when you follow him, you are blessed. Notice what Mary says. He took notice of me, and from now on, all generations. She's going, listen, remember what I told you a while ago? Joseph's family looked at her and said, she's a slut. She's gone from being a slut to being a saint. All generations will call her blessed. Listen, this Christmas season, I've got something to sing about because I am blessed. I'm blessed like Mary. Regardless of my circumstance, regardless of my situation, my God has noticed me. And he has blessed me. See, all too often we treat God like Santa Claus. We go get on his lap and give him our list, and this is the things that we want. God doesn't use chimneys. He uses the cross. It is the cross that makes the difference, that changes us and changes things. Mary confessed, all generations will call me blessed. And this is where we get off track. We go, well, but that was Mary. She is the mother of Jesus. You know what Romans 8 tells me? Romans 8 says, I'm the brother of Jesus. I got something to sing about. Because I am the brother of Jesus Christ. And Romans 8 goes on to say, I'm not just his brother, but I am a joint heir with Jesus. That means everything he gets is mine too. Everything coming his way is mine as well. And I got to remind you, God doesn't work like Santa Claus. Don't give him your list of wants. Here's what I will tell you. He's already given you the most important gift of all. He gave his son Jesus to die on the cross so you could be forgiven. So you could join in the song, I'm living a white Christmas. I am forgiven and I am his. I've got lots to sing about. She found that the God, when she submitted to the God that does the impossible, he would bless her life so much other people would notice it. You go back and you read the verses just preceding it, and Mary comes to the place after the angel appears to her, and she says, let it be to me, the servant of the Lord. And then the next line says, she says, I don't know how this is going to happen. The next line goes, with God, nothing is impossible. Listen, we should celebrate. We should sing. Because with the God we serve, nothing is impossible. We should join with Mary and sing in a song of Christmas. We should rejoice in all that God has done for us. Number four in your outline. I have a song to sing, number one, when I focus on God, not my situation. I have a song to sing, number two, when I have found my Savior. Number three, when I realize that when I follow God, I am blessed. Number four, when I see how God's mercy changes things. When I begin to see how God's mercy changes things. Notice what Mary says in verses 49 and 50. For the Mighty One is holy. And he's done great things for me. He shows his mercy from generation to generation to all who fear him. Mary sings knowing who God is. He is mighty, he is holy, and he is the doer of great things. She says that he shows his mercy from generation to generation to all who will fear him. I don't think we get the mercy of God. I'll let you in on a secret. I look pretty good today. Okay, so that's not a secret. I know that's why you're kind of laughing. I do look pretty good. I'm all dressed up Christmassy and everything, even right down to my Christmas socks and all kinds of stuff. But you know what? I can look good on the outside and be empty on the inside. You can show up for church on Sunday morning and look good on the outside, make a good appearance, but be empty on the inside. Mary says something really interesting here. She says that she understands and knows who God is, and she knows the mercy of God. That's mercy is not getting what I deserve. Mercy is God giving me better than I deserved. I've got a song to sing. Because what I deserve is to be struck down because of my sins. Can you imagine what would happen to you if this week coming up, God just decided, okay, we're pulling back all the restraints. You mess up, you're going down. The first time you thought the wrong thing. The first time you acted in the wrong way. I mean, it wouldn't be that kind of clap. It'd be kind of lightning bolts kind of stuff, you know. Frizzy hair and the whole 6 miles. What would happen? But see, that's not the mercy of God. You and I should be singing because of the mercy of God. Because He is so good and so gentle and so kind. She uses the phrase, fear Him. Now remember, we're celebrating Christmas, not Halloween. This is not the kind of fear where you go over into the corner because you're afraid of Him. It's because you recognize the grandeur of who He is. She talks about Him being mighty and holy and able to do great things. You and I, we've got a song to sing when we recognize how great our God really is. We stand in awe of who He is and what He can do. We recognize how powerful, how mighty, how gracious, how loving He is, and how undeserving we are. See, we sing Christmas carols. Walking in a winter wonderland, in the meadow you can build a snowman. Yeah, we're not talking about that. I'm not walking in a winter wonderland. I'm living in an eternal wonderland. I have a lot to sing about because of the one who came at Christmas. The one who was born would be the one who would die and be the one who would rise so that I could sing His praises. Mary says the mercy of God changes things. And then she gets specific. A, B, and C in your outlines. Let's look at them together. Three things God's mercy changes. Number one, the humble are exalted. His mighty arm has done tremendous things. He's scattered the proud and the haughty ones. He's brought down the princes from their thrones and exalted the humble. Now, He's not talking about Christians being these little people that are kind of mealy-mouthed, you know, that go, we're so meek and mild, we all wear dark and we don't want to be seen, we don't want to draw any attention to ourselves, we just kind of sit off in the corner. That's not what it means to be humble. He's talking about us being humble from the sense of knowing that we desperately, desperately, desperately need a Savior. The proud are those who think that they're good enough. Those that are going to be brought down are those who believe in all their heart that their good deeds are enough and they're sufficient. Jeremiah says this, that you don't have any soap and you don't have any lie that is strong enough to remove the stain of your sin. There is nothing we can do to clean ourselves up. On your best day, on my best day, we still are missing the mark. But there's a song to sing because God has sent someone to remove the stain of our sin. And that one was the babe born in Bethlehem. But the only ones that have that applied are not the ones who think they're good enough, but the ones who recognize, I desperately need a Savior. The ones that recognize, I'm not good enough. No matter how hard I try, I can't do enough. I can't be enough. I can't become enough. I can't work hard enough. I can't give enough, say enough, sing enough. The humble are those who say, God, I need what you have. And the only way to get it is through the one who was born at Christmas. The only way to receive it is to put my faith in the Christ. God's mercy changes things. It elevates the humble. God's mercy changes things. The hungry are filled. He's filled the hungry with good things, and the rich He sent away with empty hands. Those recognizing their lack will be filled, and those that are smug, thinking that they've got it all figured out, they'll end up going away empty. Jesus, back in Matthew chapter 5, he said this. He said in the Beatitudes, He said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." There's a song to sing. If we hunger and thirst for the righteousness that only God can provide. If we hunger and thirst for the righteousness that only God can give and grant. If we hunger and thirst for the righteousness that only the perfect one could live up to. Got a song to sing. We can dream about a white Christmas, or we can live a white Christmas. I am forgiven, and I'm His. Not only does it change the humble being exalted and the hungry are filled, see the hurting are helped. He's helped His servant Israel and remembered to be merciful. Israel was God's chosen people, and they were hurting. The Romans were in control. They were running everything. The religious leaders were corrupt. But Mary confesses that God has reached down in His mercy and taken care of the hurt. He's provided a way out of the hurting. Listen, all of us have certain hurts, habits, and hang-ups that we struggle with, that we have to deal with. And I have to tell you, the solution came at Christmas. The solution for every problem you face in life came at Christmas. It came wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. It came as a gift to you and a gift to me. And by embracing that gift, by believing that gift, by accepting the baby that was born, that lived and grew and died and rose, we find the solution for our souls, the salvation of our lives, the answer to our problems. Listen, you will never have a song to sing until you look upon Jesus and look to Him for your hope. It is Christ that we turn to. Last one, the promise of God's mercy changes things forever. Notice what she says. She says, "For He's made this promise to our ancestors, to Abraham and his children forever." Forever. This is a happily ever after song. This is a happily into eternity song. This is not a New Year's resolution. This is not something that I'm going to state today that it's going to be over with tomorrow because I'm going to fail miserably at it. This is about what God has done. I have a song to sing because of what God did that first Christmas. I can walk in a winter wonderland because it's an eternal wonderland in His presence, seeing what He will do. I can sing the song that I'm living in this white Christmas era because of what the baby did from Bethlehem. I'm living a white Christmas. I am forgiven, and I'm His. That's the song that I want to sing. You want to join me? Can you sing that song? Are you living in this forever, this eternal land of wonder? This presence of God in your heart and in your life. If you're a follower of Christ, we ought to be singing. Because we've got lots to sing about. So how do we start the song? We're going to change. We're not going to use the the three cells that we normally use. I'm going to give you three things to do. First, right out of Mary's song, focus on God. This Christmas, we just need to stop and focus on God. Doesn't matter what's under the tree. Doesn't matter what comes down the chimney. Those things are secondary issues. You want to learn to sing, focus on God. Focus on Him. Don't just focus on Him, but find your Savior. Find in the babe of Bethlehem the one who would die on the cross for your sins. You want a song to sing? Focus on God and find the Savior. And lastly, follow Him. When we follow Him, here's what Mary sang. I follow Him and I'm blessed. And I'm blessed. I'm dreaming. No. I'm living a white Christmas. My sins forgiven and I'm His. What a song. We need to do a rewrite. And we need to sing this Christmas. Let's bow together. Father, thank you.